I've had significant ER experience. I have dealt with losing patients my whole career and the aftermath of families losing loved ones my whole career. But COVID is something entirely different. We throw everything we have at it and we still lose patients anyway. And that's the hardest thing. Like, losing families, it's the aftermath of that, of the loss of a patient, that's the hardest thing.
I mean, the ER has always been busy. It's always been a challenging job. We've always had high patient volumes and the sickest patients around, but I've never felt quite this stretched thin before. Like, it comes with the territory of being an ER nurse.
Well, emergency departments are always challenging places to work. You're dealing with patients who are dealing with acute illnesses that they weren't expecting. So it's always been a challenging, stressful place to work. We call it organized chaos. To us, it's organized. To other people, probably it looks like a mess, but we just kind of adjust to any changes that occur. So that's one of our strengths.
I did a lot of work with families and patients before COVID. We would have a whole lot of family members here, which unfortunately, since the pandemic has started, we've not been able to have as many family members here. So that has changed my job quite a bit in that I am having to almost stand in for families sometimes and provide support to patients even more than I already did. Situations where we have a person who is dying, where maybe only one or two family members can be here, sometimes none of them can be here. And I will be with that patient through that.
Seeing a family have to say goodbye to a mother through a pane of glass, catching a wife who's just heard that her husband didn't make it. I mean, we are struggling. It's hard to see that much loss and that much heartache and palpable sorrow for such a long period of time. And to have hope that maybe it's gonna end and then have this second surge hit again has been devastating for many of us. It's hard. It's really hard.
I'm doing a lot more staff care than I did before. I've been very worried about our staff. I see a lot of traumatic stress. I see a lot of burnout. I see a lot of very experienced, caring, very good providers who have left the bedside because of COVID.
You know, we used to be able to go more liberally into patients' rooms, or if someone arrived in distress, there was not this moment where you freeze and you're like, hang on, let me put on everything before I go help them. You just go, you just jump on it. It's been so stifling. Extra separation and extra eggshells to walk on just to get people what they need.
I know people think it's not a threat to me and it's not a problem for me, but just think about the people you love most in this world and how they would feel if you weren't there any longer. That's why we care about these people. We care about each and every one of them. It doesn't matter to me what your socioeconomic status is, where you fall on political lines. None of that matters to me. I care about each and every patient that walks into this building, that walks into these rooms. And that's the people we want to save, and we need help saving them. The best thing that anybody can do is help us save you by taking a step to help save yourself. These deaths are preventable.
My emergency people, they do a fabulous job and they are overwhelmed. In the emergency department, we're used to dealing with large numbers of people. We're used to dealing with a lot of patients coming in. What we were not used to is as sick as so many of them are, and the pace with which we're caring for them.
I helped intubate a gentleman, and we asked him prior to intubation if he would like to call his family, and he wasn't sure what to say, and he ended up not taking that opportunity, and we didn't have time to impress upon him the severity of this, the reality that he might not get that opportunity again. And I went home and I grappled with this a lot. And actually, I talked with my husband about this a lot. And it's like, I don't know if I should have pressured him more or if that would be too much stress in an already stressful situation for him. Because he did get intubated, and it's the emergency department. So these people, we only see the front end. We don't know how it turns out. But I struggled and was like, was that the right thing? Should we really have pressed more? We didn't have a lot of time. And I struggled, and my husband was like, why are you so fixated on this? And I was like, because it's gonna happen again. This is not gonna be the last person who comes in very sick that has a couple moments to decide, do we wanna make a phone call? Do you wanna make it? Do we need to make it before they get intubated? It's going to be, and it wasn't. We've done that.
And I think that's a huge takeaway. I think people think that it's not going to affect me. It's going to affect somebody else who's older or sicker. But it knows no boundaries. It doesn't care what race you are, what religion you are.
I wish I could take you down the hallways and see all the young people on ventilators or who are turned on their stomachs, or who are on an artificial heart-lung machine because their lungs don't work anymore. I wish I could have you sit down and just spend 10 minutes listening to our nurses, our respiratory therapists, our techs, just about their fears for their families, their fears for their children. I wish I could bring you in to see.
You know, what are the risks if I were to contract COVID? What are the benefits of the vaccine? Because you can spread it to your family, you can spread it to children. Children who don't have vaccinated adults in their lives, they can bring it home from school and spread it to those adults. Those adults can spread it to children. It's very real. And this particular variant has made young people very sick. They are not immune. They're not out of the woods just because they're young.
I cannot stress enough how crucial this vaccine is. We just don't have enough resources to take care of everybody. We just don't. There's so much information, viable, reliable information about this vaccine. Sure, there's lots of other information that's unreliable. So the information that you get, make sure that it's real information and not fake information. That's okay to have questions, and it's okay to have concerns. But make sure the decision you make is one that's based on real information. I mean, we cannot do it without them. We cannot do it without everybody pulling together to fight it together. We cannot.